My name is Luciano Pellegrini. I'm the executive chef at Valentino Restaurant at The Venetian and also a partner at Giorgio Ristorante and Mandalay Place, both restaurants in Las Vegas. I began working actually while I was going to school. I worked between school years in the summer. I also worked Christmas break, spring break. Anytime I had a break, you know, our teacher would encourage us to go out there and just practice, practice, practice. So since I was, let's say, 14 years old, I've been working, you know, in various restaurants and establishments around my hometown. And I eventually worked for about a couple of years at Ristorante Locanda dell'Angelo in Bergamo, my hometown, until I had to put in my year, required year in the military service, which I served in Pisa, part of the parachuters. And that is where I first began to learn how to cook for the masses. I eventually ended up in a kitchen there and, you know, cooked up food for 3,000 to 4,000 people at lunch and, you know, the same for dinner 7 days a week. Then after that, I eventually did pick up a seasonal job by the Italian Riviera for a few months for the summer, right off military school. And then I ended up spending half of the winter by Lake Garda before the opportunity came to come to America. That was 1985. And I have been working for Piero Selvaggio since 1985. Began at Valentino in Santa Monica and then opened Premier Restaurant in July of 1985, where I worked for about 7 years. And then we opened Posto Restaurant in the San Fernando Valley in Los Angeles. And I worked there for about 7 years until we came to Las Vegas in 1999, and I've been at Valentino ever since. Today I'm gonna prepare a chicken parmigiana dish served with spelt linguine in a marinara sauce. Hi there, I'm Luciano Pellegrini. I'm the chef at Valentino at The Venetian, and today with me I have our friend Lucy and Nico.
Nico Chessa at Giorgio Mandalay Place.
Our sister restaurant. Today we're gonna prepare our version of chicken parmigiana. It is a diabetic friendly version. It's gonna have wheat bread breading, not with flour, and we're gonna serve with that a spelt spaghetti with marinara salt. Spelt being like the forefather of wheat, but it is in its whole grain form, which is, you know, of course, better for anybody that has a diabetes problem.
Absolutely.
Very healthy. So actually, Nico is gonna help me out today, and he's gonna start the marinara for me.
Fantastic.
And possibly cook the pasta, while at the same time, I'm actually gonna start preparing the chicken here. So I'm gonna slice the chicken and get it all ready, beat the egg, and in the meanwhile, I think Nico might.
I need the help of Lucy. I need some olive oil.
Oh, there you go, Lucy.
Lucy, thank you so much. A little drizzle, like Luciano says.
Yep, it's famous drizzle.
So in the meanwhile here, I'm cutting the chicken breast about a quarter of an inch thick.
So you could use chicken or veal?
Well, right, absolutely, yes. I mean, and beef and any kind of meat that you want. I mean, the preparation is the one, and whatever ingredients you use will change the recipe around. So we're gonna make, let's make enough.
What do you got going in here?
I got some sliced garlic and shallot that I wanna do the sofrito, like we say in Italy. Just pre-cook nice and crispy. When they are translucent, they change color, they are ready to add any flavor that you are. In this case, basil, and then the tomato.
So what exactly is a sofrito, Nico? Not that I don't know, but perhaps for
sure,
the benefit
of
our
audience. I don't know, but just in case you need some information too, also for you. Sofrito is because it's not like a deep fry. It's a pan fry, the base, veggies that you use, or in the most of the cases in Italy, parsley, garlic, onions, or spices like a chili pepper, and that is why you do the sofrito, and then you add your sauce. In this case, tomato, cream, or whatever you're using. And also, they use a lot lardo or pancetta to give more flavor to it.
And that
so,
is
in
what?
A few minutes, it's almost ready.
A pancetta is what?
Pancetta is pancia, is mean belly. So the belly of the pork.
Okay.
They skewer, and again, used in many recipes. We try to lighten up in most of the cases, so we don't use them much, but...
And what can you use if you don't find pancetta?
Bacon here in the States, for sure.
But we're not using bacon today, right?
Knowing this recipe.
Okay, good.
No.
So in the meanwhile here, I'm got my chicken sliced and seasoned with salt and pepper. I got a couple of eggs here that I just beat with a fork, and then I'm just going to put my chicken in it.
And you can do chicken fingers too, Luciano, right? Like that?
Well, you can do, absolutely, you can actually do chicken fingers too. But, you know, and this will actually give you a hardier texture, you know, the actual breast. Fingers will definitely be a very tender proposition. But chicken finger is...
Another version of it?
Absolutely. Well, and you wouldn't have to cut them, slice them, whatever, you just use
ready
them as
to
they
go.
Are, ready to go.
And what else do you have in the, with the wheat bread?
Just wheat bread. I just took some wheat bread and I just grated it. And so you put in there just tomato puree, my friend.
I'm adding the tomato puree. And this, Luciano, if I am right, they are San Marzano.
San Marzano, yes, from Italy.
Which make a little difference. They are sweeter.
Sweeter.
Right, Luciano?
Yep.
Compared to the other commercial
tomatoes. Some tomato, yeah. That definitely had that characteristic. So I'm getting my bread nicely soaked here. I mean, my bread, my chicken, nicely soaked in the egg. Just like that. And then I'm going to pull this off to the side. I'm going to put my breadcrumbs right over here. Like I said, this is whole wheat bread. Go to a grocery store, get a whole wheat bread loaf, let it dry out a little bit, and then you put it in a food processor. And you got a nice
homemade crumbs. They don't sell them just like that, huh?
I never saw them, but yeah, they could be. So as you see, they have a nice brown coloring.
You said this is diabetic friendly?
Well, I mean, like I said, you know, it's bread and it's whole wheat, whole grain bread. Mm-hmm. So your body will break it down much slower than if it was refined flour bread. Okay. So, and since we're making Parmigiana that is breaded, then it would definitely be better than if it had regular breadcrumbs.
Okay. How long does this cook?
This can cook for about 15 to 20 minutes. Usually we do a simple tomato sauce. They cook in the same time the pasta is done. Mm-hmm. When you are hungry in a rush.
Yeah.
And they come up, if the ingredient is good, still come up with a nice, nice, nice flavor.
Right.
At home.
And actually, when you do have a good tomato, you don't want to overcook it and
Correct. Change
the flavors too much anyway. So you usually, when you have a lesser product, you actually add more stuff and...
Who knows what is in there?
But
especially if the thickness is already there, you know it to cook longer to have the, let's say, water evaporate. So,
well, would you help here, Lucy, and pour me some olive oil in this pan?
Well, I get to do the drizzle.
No, we're not drizzling now. We're just pouring.
All right.
Yeah, you pour. So,
good.
As I never, yeah, that will be fine. Mm-hmm. As I will never tire of saying, I always like to start with a hot pan. It just saves me having to wait for the oil to heat up for me to pour my meat in. So I'm going to start pouring my chicken in.
This takes about how long?
This will take about 10, 15 minutes overall. So the pasta, I think, will take less than 10 minutes. Actually, this will take just as long as the pasta would take.
You want me to throw the pasta in there, Luciano?
Just because the chicken is cut so thin anyway. So, I think...
if it's the same time of cooking?
Now's the time. Put your spelt spaghetti in the water, which we previously salted.
Absolutely. Which we call farro in Italy.
Right. And then when we come back, we'll talk more about what spelt is, what farro is, and the goodness of it all.
Fantastic.
Yes,
I'm going.
So we'll get to that later. Love the pasta, and we'll be right back. And if you missed any of these steps, please go to cheflife.com, and you can catch up on anything we did until now. We'll catch you later. My favorite food growing up, I don't know that I could pinpoint one. My mom wasn't a gourmet cook, but she definitely did her home cooking flawlessly. We usually couldn't wait until the holidays came around because that meant lasagna and it meant the roasted meats and it meant the antipasti platters and just the overall bonanza that was associated with the holidays. Definitely the season played a part in whatever food we ate, and I can always remember having polenta snails in the spring and incredible watermelons and tomato salads out of our garden in the summer. And whenever hunting season was open, we usually had polenta and roasted birds, one of my ultimate favorites. And then come winter, we would always slaughter a pig, and it would be salami making day, and there was we were just feasting on all kinds of good stuff. So I definitely think that there was a lot of emotions that I put into my career, into my job, into cooking and anything associated with cooking, and I also got an incredible amount of satisfactions and rewards out of the process.
Oh, it's cooking fast, huh?
Yeah, and welcome back, everybody. So as you see, I'm actually just now turning my chicken. So you need to kind of be careful. The breadcrumbs kind of tend to color real fast, so they get to burn as quickly. So you want to definitely be careful. You don't need to cook the chicken by frying in a pan. We're going to stick it in the oven and cook it later anyway. So here I am. I'm done. You're passing about 5 minutes away.
Give you 5 minutes, just the right time to finish that one in the oven.
So what I'm going to do is actually, I'm sorry. I'm going to put some garlic in there and some shallot and some basil.
Very good.
Yeah.
They give it the right flavor.
And then we got over here, when you put the pasta in, you didn't break it, because I've always, my family always breaks the pasta, throws
this
it in.
This is just
the
for kids, so they don't choke.
Oh, okay.
For adults, we like to roll them up in the
whole
length.
Like old Italy, right?
Correct.
Turn it
right.
With the spoon and the fork?
No spoon.
No spoon. Just with a fork. Avvolgibile.
Okay.
So I'm actually going to flip the chicken so that I get all the shallot and the garlic right down into the pan, and I'll do, just like Nico did before, my own sofrito. So I'm gonna prepare the basis for the sauce for the chicken. So I'm actually gonna add some marinara here as well. Some tomato, actually some puree, tomato puree. So I'm pretty much repeating the steps that Nico did with the sauce. I have my tomato puree, which I told him to save me some earlier. And I'm going to pour this one in.
Now, do you make this in a processor too, the puree? Or
yeah, just put in
tomato?
A full processor, just canned tomato, whole tomatoes, mm-hmm. And then you just blend it all. That's all. So nice and fresh. You don't want to pre-do the sauce. You want actually to cook a little bit of tomato with the chicken, so that the tomato will taste like the chicken will taste like the tomato, and so on and so forth.
Now, how do you make sure you don't overcook your pasta? What's like a trick? Or?
This is the trick. Four minutes away.
Okay.
And if the pasta is ready before any preparation you do, you drain it about a minute ahead, so it can hold 3-4 minutes sitting there. Actually, even better, get
so cook.
They cook with the sauce, basically, and they make loaf with the sauce, and all the flavors kind of get together.
Yeah. You know, these Italians, they're all passionate.
About passionate love,
very,
absolutely.
Yes, yeah. We're very passionate about love, and then espresso. Mm-hmm. And our pasta al dente, for sure.
Absolutely.
So here I got my sauce. As you can see, it's somewhat thickening, also mm-hmm. because the bread will add as a starch and will thicken the sauce. So actually, I'm going to add a little bit of water, or if you want to, of course, chicken stock if you have it available. Then I'm going to actually try this and see if I have enough. If I season the salt enough, then that would have passed on to the sauce, which means the sauce will be okay. If it didn't, then I need to flavor the sauce as well. Otherwise, you would have something that it's a little bit on the tasteless side. So, need to add a little more salt. Absolutely. Salt does make all better.
I need some salt here too, Luciano, please.
Why don't you?
I like it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Someone, we like it.
Or you can use this one. This is already made.
I don't like it.
Want some pepper?
A little pepper. Too much.
So then over here, I actually have my fresh mozzarella. Again, Parmigiana would entail the use of Parmesan cheese, Parmigiano. However, for some reason, we always like the stringiness and flavor of fresh mozzarella. We actually use a combination of both. And at this point, I'm actually lowering the heat because I just want the sauce to simmer. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to just slice mozzarella in little pieces. I'm going to try and have a little slice for each.
It smells so good.
For each piece of chicken that I have. And so I'm just going to do like that. Put in a pan.
And the oven, what should be the temperature for the oven,
well,
Luciano?
Well, like I said, the dish at this point is somewhat ready. So, and for instance, you could actually, if you want to prepare ahead, you can actually prepare the chicken up to this point, even turn, after you put the tomato sauce in, you can actually turn the fire off, put your cheese on top, and let it dead, keep and hold, and then, you know, prepare an hour or so ahead, and then when you're ready to serve, just pop it in the oven, very hot oven, for like 5 minutes.
Just to reheat it.
Just to reheat, and then you can serve. So I did that. I'm going to add some Parmesan cheese right over that.
So we got the mozzarella, Parmesan.
The Parmesan. Oh, I think I missed this part, so I'm going to cheat and...
No cheese for day one.
No cheese.
Cheese left.
That's a bad chicken.
And I think we're ready to pop this in the oven.
Very good.
For
let me
second.
Open the oven for you.
Your pasta should be almost ready.
I can
right?
enjoy the pasta at the same time.
So I put this in. We're going to come back to it in, I just close it.
Good.
There you go.
So it's pretty much cooked now? Just
it's pretty much cooked. So we just all we have to do is just wait for the mozzarella to melt a little bit. Then the pasta is ready.
Ready.
We're going to drain the pasta. And we're going to drain the pasta, put it in a bowl. And then when we come back, we're going to dress it and then put it all together for you so that you can see how delicious it all tastes. We'll be right back. If you missed any step, don't forget, go to cheflife.com and you can catch up on anything you might have missed. See you in a little bit. And welcome back. I was actually smelling the one that we're going to serve with this course. It smells delicious. Can I have to try some? Nico, you ready with the pasta?
Yes, but I don't got to smell the wine though.
Later.
Okay.
If you behave.
Like I would say, we drain the pasta. We drizzle with a little olive oil because it's 2 minutes ahead of the preparation, in this case, the chicken right. that we're doing. And it's ready to toast the 20 minutes marinara on it.
Oh, that's beautiful. Mm-hmm. And by the way, guys, if I know that I mentioned, if you want to prepare the chicken parmigiana ahead, how to do it. Same thing goes with the pasta. You can actually prepare your sauce ahead and let it ready to stand by. And you can actually cook your pasta at the same time. The only thing is you want to leave it at least 4 to 5 minutes behind what the instructions said you have to cook the pasta for. Because by the time you take it out, it's going to continue cooking and it's going to become almost al dente by the time it gets cold. And then right before you're ready to serve, you can actually take the pasta, drop it into the sauce, bring the sauce up to boil, and by the time everything gets nice and hot, your pasta will be perfect.
What's al dente?
Al dente means to the tooth, which means it has somewhat, like the inner core is still a little bit raw and crunchy.
Crunch.
And so it adds you that little texture. So it's not a gummy pasta, it's actually pasta with a texture.
Oh.
Al dente.
Okay.
But I think the chicken will be ready, so I think we want to take that out. And I'm coming.
Looks ready.
Right behind you, Lucy. And look at that.
Nice.
I think we got a winner here. So I think we're ready to plate this up, right?
You want to do family style? You want to do, what do
you
want to do with
this? I'm going to just prepare a little nice family style dish. I got a nice platter here. I'm going to, you know what I need is a spoon. I'll borrow that spatula you got.
You can borrow the spatula, yes, you can.
I can actually put my spaghetti right here to the side.
So that pasta's a little different color. What kind of?
So, yeah, we mentioned before this is spelt. So spelt is a wheat. It's called actually the forefather of wheat. It traces back to the Roman time, to the Etruscan time. That's the type of wheat that they used to eat. And there are many preparations. You can actually use spelt and use it as a whole grain and boil it like you do barley. In this case, they actually make ground flour and make pasta or bread out of it. It is in its whole grain form, and it actually has a very low glycemic index, which is good for diabetes.
Yes.
Takes a longer time for the body to break the starch down into sugar, and you get the pleasure of having pasta without the guilt of associated with how unhealthy it might be. So then we're going to lay our chicken parm right there. Let's see this barrel of olive oil is in the way. I don't want to knock it over.
What are you going to do with the olive oil in the kitchen, Luciano?
I drink me a glass of it. And I'm going to scoop up some of the sauce here.
Very good. It's beautiful.
Like that.
My mouth is watering like crazy.
It is. Actually, it's very good looking dish, very colorful, and the flavor is just unbelievable. Then, speaking of color, I do have here some extra basil, and I'm going to add some parsley, fresh parsley, Italian parsley.
Mm-hmm. You ever put wild wine in your sauces?
Yes.
You can?
Yes. Depends. On
in the sofrito, even after, so keep the color. Right.
And what I'm going to do, just a rough chop. I don't want to have a fine chop, and then just going to sprinkle this over the top, all over the plate. And a little bit of crushed pepper.
Very good.
I love these damn things. And guess what I'm going to do next?
Drizzle of olive oil.
Drizzle, man.
Drizzle of olive oil. There you go. And diabetic-friendly chicken parm. Enjoy. Actually, you know what? I think I'm going to try the pasta.
Me too. I can't wait.
I
can
know.
We do this on camera?
I think once.
Yes, we should.
It's our kitchen. We could do
it's
what
our
we want.
Kitchen. You can do the
good
same
job,
at home.
Nico.
Thank
right.
you.
Wait, this is not going to be easy.
Anyway, again, if you missed any of the steps of this recipe, go to cheflife.com and you can pause and speed up.
That
as,
was great.
As
really
you
good.
Thank you. You got a smile.
Oh, no, I can't do that.
And we'll catch you next time.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bartender, listen here, I ain't here for trouble, so hey.